In Shandong Province, China, the internet allows a wheelchair-bound entrepreneur to make a living selling cattle. In rural Kenya, mobile money brings life-changing aid to individuals living in extreme poverty. In Estonia, a sophisticated online system allows one-stop shopping to apply for licenses, pay taxes, and even vote. And in India, close to 1 billion people sign up for a digital ID that promises to make opening a bank account much easier. In London, Nairobi, Beijing, Barcelona, and Delhi, mobile phones seem omnipresent. But though digital technologies are spreading rapidly, digital dividends, faster growth, more jobs, and better services are not. What's holding back countries from realizing the profound and transformational effects that digital technologies are supposed to deliver? Those are some of the themes of the World Bank's World Development Report 2016, Digital Dividends. The technology of the internet alone is not enough. The digital revolution needs analog foundations. Workers need education and the skills that will enable them to participate fully in the new economy. And nations need institutions that are open and accountable to their citizens. When those are present, developing nations can grow. When the internet is accessible, opportunities expand. With smart policies, improved services can be delivered. But when those analog complements to digital investments are missing, the development impact can be disappointing. This video uses four case studies to show what's possible and what's needed for digital dividends to be more accessible to everyone, everywhere, and to deliver inclusion, efficiency, and innovation. This is what a day in the life of the internet looks like. There are 36 million purchases from Amazon, more than 150 million Skype calls, 186 million images uploaded to Instagram, more than 2 billion gigabytes of web traffic, 4.2 billion searches using Google, 207 billion emails, more than 800 million tweets, and nearly 9 billion YouTube videos being watched. And by the time you're seeing this, those numbers will likely have grown. In less than two decades, cell phones have become widely dispersed across the planet. On average, 8 in 10 individuals in the developing world own a mobile phone, with that number steadily rising. More households in developing countries own a mobile phone than have access to electricity or clean water. Some choose to spend as much as 13% of their monthly income on calls and messages. But though mobile phones have become almost universal, as indicated by Deep Purple, internet adoption lags behind, especially in the developing world. Much is at stake: inclusion in the workforce, efficiency in delivering services, the innovation that fuels growth in a digital economy. Around the world, more than 1 billion people have disabilities, and 80% of them live in developing countries. They face serious barriers to participating in the social and financial revolution that's underway. China's rapid economic growth has brought 500 million people out of poverty. And as of 2014, nearly 650 million Chinese use the internet.
然后买东西啊，可以直接就跟现，就是比如说那卖家在聊10万8千里之外，你还可以跟他聊天啊什么的，就很方便。The
central government has promoted broadband and the internet as a great equalizer in rural areas and cities like Zhejiang and Shandong province, and it's benefited some of China's 80 million disabled. Hong Weimeng had a promising future until a terrible auto accident changed his life.
胸部一下整个都没有知觉，整个就是下肢整个下身都瘫痪，不能动。所以从那之后呢，直接就是说，等于失去了工作，失去了，就是肺能一样，等屎一样的人一样。By
the end of 2015, more than 90% of villages had fixed broadband access. That had opened up an opportunity for Mr. Meng. Shandong had a reputation for high-quality livestock, and China has some 80 million farmers. Although one of Meng's first businesses, an internet cafe, had failed, he thought there might be a way to sell livestock online. It was tough at first, but soon customers trusted that he would deliver.
我们怎么做呢？就是我们觉得就是说，在现场中把那个牛、羊、驴，就活牛、活羊、活马，把它图片拍下来。
Before his accident, Meng had trained as an engineer, so he already had the education and technical skills to take advantage of the internet revolution that swept his nation. Today, Meng employs a staff of six, all disabled in some way. He's developed a network of local suppliers who trust him to sell their animals. And he's won awards for being a successful netrepreneur and a tough negotiator.
可能如果没有互联网，可能，对外人来说，高维阶层可能就是废人，因为你没法，没有就是说双手去劳动，没有双手去走路，这意味着你什么也干不了。我相信就是说，正是这些平台，正是阿里的这些平台，改变了我的生活，改变了我的家庭。
Today, Meng encourages others, giving computer classes at the local China Disabled Persons Federation. As the 2016 World Bank report has found, it takes training and support systems to include all who can benefit from the internet. But securing digital dividends in China also required many analog complements, such as reliable electricity and a transportation infrastructure of roads, rail, and air to enable e-commerce to grow. In this favorable business environment, Alibaba and other online platforms have made it possible for small businesses like Meng's to connect with customers by reducing coordination costs and boosting efficiency. China's State Information Center estimates that the recent boom in the e-commerce sector has created 10 million jobs in online stores and related services, about 1.3% of the country's total employment. 40% are owned by women, and 1% of sellers are disabled. Such changes are not limited to economic transactions. Worldwide, they also influence the participation of women in the workforce. Offline, women make up just 25% of the labor market. Online, according to one survey of digital workers, it's 44%. Yao Hua Wu is Alibaba's Director of Opportunities for the Disadvantaged.
在对于残疾人在那个使用互联网，那我们在做的一件事情呢，是从无障碍的角度去完善他们的一个体验，跟正常人一样啊，对吧？这个其实一样的这些东西。然后呢，在这个环节当中，其实我们看得到，就是残疾人以及相关的弱势群体，比如说像单亲的母亲、女性这种弱势群体，那他们原本在线下他们的工作。 其实是我们可以看到，甚至有一些就业的歧视。那在网络上面，他们完全不存在这一块。所以说，有时候自己就是说，我忘记我自己是个残疾人，就是说，在生活状态呢，我可能觉得我和正常人一样，我没什么。What
steps can governments take to promote growth and empower citizens? Estonia's X-Road is an internet-based e-government system that enables participating institutions, including private business, to communicate and exchange data. Along with companies such as Skype, it's been one reason a relatively small nation such as Estonia has become a world leader.
Here in my country, in Estonia, we have come a very long way, and we've done it in the past two decades. In this digital world, the size of a country does not matter as much anymore. Technology allows us to be bigger than we physically are.
The internet has the potential to change the economic geography of our world. Here, a nation's size is scaled by average income. The richer its citizens, the larger its outline and the deeper the color. But if you look at the proportion of their citizens online, Brazil, India, and China, for example, grow larger. If being online, like Estonia, can lead to sustainable economic development, it can be a tool to tackle poverty and change the world for the good. X-Road is one-stop shopping for licenses, taxes, and much more. Citizens never have to provide the same information twice, whether paying for parking or even voting. And it has strong built-in protection for users in order to encourage participation.
The foundation of a successful digital society is trust. In the cyber world, you must know who it is that's looking at your data, who you're talking to. Or to recall a famous cartoon from about 20 years ago, on the internet, no one knows you're a dog. Here in Estonia, our e-services function extremely well, precisely because we have paid so much attention to the issue of identity, which allows our citizens to trust giving their data to whoever they wish to give it to.
With strong analog protections in place, X-Road has experienced phenomenal growth. It launched in 2003 with 10 participating institutions. By 2013, almost 900 had joined. In 2014, Estonia's population of 1.3 million made 113 million queries through X-Road. If e-services like X-Road are assumed to cut 30 minutes from each interaction, then in 2014, that saved more than 56 million hours. Divide that by a population of 1.3 million, and that adds up to 5.4 workdays per citizen.
Of course, the effects of digital development on society far exceed those of simply the economy. From our own experience, I can say that it's a huge benefit and boost to the development of countries, which allows a small and rather poor country 20 years ago to become much more developed and functionally much larger, being able to do things in this country that before the digital age would not be possible for a place as small as we are.
The same promise of leapfrogging ahead can also be seen here. Nairobi, Kenya. It took 60 years following the invention of electricity for it to become widespread here. It took cell phones more than 15 years to reach 70% penetration in the United States. In Kenya, about 8 years to reach almost everybody. And Kenya's M-Pesa mobile money payment scheme reached 80% of households in 4 years, and now seems almost universal. Mobile money had started as informal swaps of airtime credit, and so grew without the kind of regulations applied to banks. By the end of 2013, 17 million Kenyans, more than two-thirds of the adult population, were using M-Pesa to pay electric bills and buy coffee, food, or gasoline. Millicent Apio sells secondhand clothing in a Nairobi market. And like many Kenyans, she sends money back to relatives in the countryside.
Maisha ilikuwa ngumu bila M-Pesa. Nilikuwa labda upate mtu kama ni nyumbani, upate mwenye anaenda nyumbani, umpatie, na zingine hiyo pesa ifiki, labda atakuwa na kuwa ni mzuri, kuwe tu na pesa, ule pia kuna simu. Sekunde tu, kubonyeza imeingia. Kuna shida, dakika kidogo.
Monica Karatz is a professor at Strathmore School of Business in Nairobi and an advisor to the World Bank Report.
In the Western world, the understanding of mobile money might not be as how we understand it and how we actually use it on a day-to-day basis. And for me, living here in Kenya, I don't think I could live without mobile money now in 2015. And I wonder how we did it before. You don't say, do I have money in the bank? You say, do I have money on my phone?
But what exactly led to the explosive growth of M-Pesa? What lessons are there for other nations?
I think it was the fact that we had no rules. It was a new platform, innovative, radical, and therefore broke the rules on what we knew about how we trade with money.
By 2013, M-Pesa was handling transactions worth about 22 billion US dollars, which, astonishingly enough, was about half of Kenya's entire gross domestic product. Mobile money and electronic transfers are also important parts of an innovative approach to international aid. One philanthropic group, GiveDirectly, uses satellite imagery, extensive groundwork, and the latest digital technology to identify some of those living in extreme poverty.
We have a staff of about 60 people. That includes field officers, administrative staff, and we also disperse a lot of money. We target around 10 to 15 million every year in US dollars.
Qualified recipients can receive up to $1,000 US. With the choice of how to spend it left entirely up to them.
Because the M-Pesa system is very robust in Kenya, that's one of the reasons why we started in Kenya first.
GiveDirectly has a careful series of steps to identify and register potential recipients like this one in Kendu Bay. If all goes well, a new recipient is enrolled and a future cash transfer is put in place.
It means using electronic payment systems to solve the last mile problem and get to our recipients. We exploit technology in ways that we feel are critical and innovative and that really enable us to scale up the model widely.
Samuel Oma received his GiveDirectly benefits in 2012 and has put the cash transfer to good use.
GiveDirectly takes a very recipient-centric focus. For us, that means taking decision-making power and putting that back in the hands of actual recipients.
GiveDirectly's successes in the field rely on a back-office staff in Kisumu, Kenya's third largest city, running sophisticated software called Segovia.
The other thing is, with Segovia having been designed in such a way that it works very closely with M-Pesa, it's very easy to make the payments at the end of the whole process.
GiveDirectly has now been operating in Kenya for 5 years and has proven the value of its innovative and even disruptive approach to international aid.
Being poor doesn't mean you're stupid. It just means that they don't have the same kinds of opportunities that the rest of us have.
The current technology that exists in the world enables us to deliver cash in a very cheap and transparent way.
But the fact that M-Pesa is used by nearly everyone does not extend to use of the internet. Here there remains a series of digital divides, not just between nations, but within them. Look at average internet usage in 12 African countries. Perhaps unsurprisingly, richer households go online more than poorer ones. Young people are online in greater numbers than older folks. City dwellers outnumber those living in the countryside. And for now, men outweigh women. So does that matter? Can the internet work its transformational magic if access is so uneven? Dr. Carrot sees great promise in the excitement of the younger generation that has led to the growth of technology labs across Africa. This is iHub in Nairobi.
I think our young people are beginning to play around with the internet, with applications, and therefore magic bullets. A magic bullet because they are challenging government, which holds a big sway in how we do things in Africa, and telling them, look, you cannot provide service in analog. You've got to change the way you provide service.
Delivering services in new and more efficient ways is what can be seen at work at massive scale in India. When you are poor and have no identification, life is hard. It may be difficult to open a bank account, establish credit, or even get a cell phone. But until recently, most of the world's population has been missing easy and universal identification. Now, India's massive universal ID program has already enrolled over 950 million people and hopes to have 1 billion signed up by mid-2016. Nandan Nilekani, a co-founder of India's Infosys, was employee number one at the government's universal ID project, Aadhaar.
This came about for two reasons. One was inclusion, so that millions of people without an ID could be in the formal system. And second, to make government spending more efficient and more accurate.
The United Nations has recognized the importance of such efforts in the post-2015 development agenda as a sustainable development goal, to provide legal identity for all, including birth registration, by 2030. Signing up for Aadhaar uses sophisticated digital technologies to capture unique individual markers, such as fingerprints and scans of the iris.
सबसे अच्छा इसमें आपका biometric. वो कोई भी आपका capture नहीं कर सकता. जिस मतलब आपका biometric सिर्फ आपकी identity बताएगा.
That means Aadhaar cuts back on fraud, and it simplifies verifying your identity.
तो आधार का सबसे प्लस पॉइंट क्या है कि आप कितनी भी बार क्लिक करवा लो लेकिन अगर एक बार आपका आधार जनरेट हो गया तो वो ही वैल्यूएबल है।
Delhi barber Mohsin Khan moved to the city in search of work and found Aadhaar worked for him.
जी दिल्ली आने से पहले मेरे पे कोई पहचान पत्र नहीं। कोई परेशानी नहीं है।
चेंज कर सकता हूँ सर जगह
जी? आधार कार्ड लेने से मेरा बैंक अकाउंट खुला है जी। आधार कार्ड बनवाते हुए मुझे कोई दिक्कत नहीं हुई। मैंने अपने नाना जी के यहाँ से एड्रेस लिया था जी। मैं जब अपनी फैमिली लेके आएंगे तो वहाँ यहाँ पे लाके मुझको रूम देखना है, रूम के बाद फिर गैस सिलेंडर देखना है, ठीक है ना, फिर अपना काम कारोबार सब कुछ देखना है जी। मेरा निकाह हुआ है 16 नवंबर।
Aadhaar proponents welcome its integrated database, but that very power worries critics.
That's where the concerns are arising from, is the creation of a centralized database which is linking different silos of data of one person. So, you know, I have my data, my bank related data in one data silo. I have another part of my life in government employment records. But Aadhaar is creating a bridge across these different silos, and that's where the concerns arise.
Right from the beginning, this whole system of unique ID was designed for privacy. For example, if the banking system uses Aadhaar for verification, all your financial information is only with the bank. It's not with the Aadhaar system.
In 2015, India's Supreme Court put restrictions in place and said that use of Aadhaar is voluntary and cannot be required to access public services. Such challenges are perhaps inevitable when something as innovative as a universal ID system for a country as massive as India is attempted.
We were planning a database of 1 billion people, and many people said this is impossible to do. So today, 5 years later, we are at 940 million, approaching 1 billion people. So I think a lot of the pioneering work in making sure the technology works, it can scale up, has all been done. The World Bank has a very ambitious goal to end extreme poverty by 2030. We believe that having a foundational ID as a public good is a critical part of it.
The lessons from China, Estonia, Kenya, and India are clear. When conditions are favorable, the internet can deliver substantial digital dividends. The inclusion of the disabled, women, and other disadvantaged groups more equitably in economic life. Greater efficiency in delivering public and private services. Innovations such as e-commerce and mobile money. But when analog complements such as the rule of law and education are missing, the dividends risk becoming a digital divide. Where governments are authoritarian, the flip side of inclusion may be control. Efficiency without open and affordable access may produce inequality. Innovation without appropriate regulations may result in monopolies or enrich local elites. Three policy objectives emerge from the report. A business environment where firms can leverage the internet to compete and innovate for the benefit of consumers. Workers, entrepreneurs, public servants, and especially young people who have the right skills to take advantage of opportunities in the digital world. An accountable government that effectively uses the internet to empower its citizens and deliver services. The stakes are high because the digital revolution leaves behind countries that do not make the necessary reforms. For those that do, technology investments will produce ample digital dividends, and these dividends will be widely shared.